Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the generous contributions from Fred and Lou Hartwig and from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to Ruckus, our weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. Ruckettes are here, and we start with the Missouri primary election this past Tuesday. It was a hat trick for Rick. Three wins in Tuesday's primaries and caucuses for Rick Santorum in the race for the GOP presidential nomination. The former senator came out on top in Missouri, Minnesota, and Colorado, and Santorum told his supporters that their voices were now being heard.
Your votes today were not just heard loud and wide across the state of Missouri and Minnesota, but they were heard loud and louder all across this country. And particularly in a place that I suspect, maybe in Massachusetts, they were heard particularly loud tonight.
The Missouri votes for Santorum do not translate to delegates to the national convention. Those delegates will be chosen in a party caucus on St. Patrick's Day. Star columnist Steve Kraske says the whole thing was costly, the outcome meaningless, and the whole thing made the state look foolish. So let's start there. Was the Missouri primary pointless, Woody?
Well, it should have been and turned out not to be for reasons completely beyond the control of anybody in Missouri. If you'd asked me that question, is this going to be pointless a week ago, I'd have said, yeah, it's going to be pointless. It doesn't pick the delegates. It costs a lot of money to hold the election. Why are we doing this? Well, as a matter of fact, two other states acted the same day, all of them Santorum carried, and all of a sudden you have something that amounts to a story of regional, if not national, of national significance that you can make out of this, even though in the case of Missouri, it doesn't account for a single delegate. You know, a few weeks ago, Gingrich was telling Santorum, you need to get out of this race so I can get all the anti-Romney votes over to me. And now it's going to be Santorum saying, Gingrich, why don't you get out of this race so I can get all these votes? And what we found in Missouri, because Gingrich didn't bother to qualify here, was what would happen if Gingrich got out of the race. He Santorum got 55% of the vote. He carried every county in the state. He got 48% plus in Jackson County. He got over 50% in St. Louis County. He crushed Romney. If you add the other votes in, the non-Ron Paul votes, a Ron Paul vote's actually a Ron Paul vote for libertarianism. That's 12%. All the rest of those votes that Santorum and other got, which is 65%, are we don't want Romney votes.
Yeah. Yale, though, the voter turnout was quite light. Can we interpret from that this movement on behalf of Santorum, at least on behalf of Missouri?
Well, I mean, the turnout was, and I guess I'll have to disagree. I think it still was meaningless. I mean, when Missouri got its name in the national headlines for a couple of days, look what those crazy people in Missouri did, and, you know, Rick Santorum still alive. And boy, do the Republicans hate Mitt Romney. I mean, that is really what I took away from it to a degree, although I also know some Democrats and independent voters who voted for Santorum just kind of for the fun of it to see, because, you know, they'd heard he's leading the polls. Little did they know he's going to get 55% of the vote, because remember, it wasn't only Republicans voting in that primary. I mean, you can go in, Barack Obama's going to get through. What's a good Democrat going to do? Try to screw with the Republican primary. And I think in a little bit, that's what they did. Final point, I do think that it was a waste of money. I really wish they had decided to make it, you know, a later primary where the delegate's going to be selected. Now, the Star said in editorially that the GOP should listen to the voters, and if they do that, Santorum's going to get most of the delegates. So we'll see if that happens.
Question is, what voters? The people, what, 3%, 7%? Some really unbelievably low number of people voted. However, every time you have American people going to the ballot box and casting, it's going to be tallied, and the cable networks nationally are just hungry to put things up on maps and make little checks in boxes. No, serious. I mean, this was, and we were going to have the returns in from Missouri here real soon. And then we have Ricky giving Rick.
Senator Santorum.
Former
senator.
Well, former senator. Everybody gets the courtesy of that title.
You know, for him, it made him look like a real contender. Yeah. And poor Newt. I mean, he didn't carry Rolla.
All right, let's move on for a second. Santorum and others are blasting the Obama administration for requiring church-affiliated employers, schools, universities, hospitals run by the Catholic Church and others, to provide employees with birth control services. There's a huge reaction to this from Santorum and others, Catholic leaders. What's going to happen to the Obama administration? Is it going to have to back off on this?
Well, I think over the past few days, what the Obama administration has done, I think, is commendable. They have acknowledged that this was a tough decision that they made, but they felt that they made the decision that was in the best interest of the masses of people who need to have access, for women who need to have access to reproductive care.
In other words, the government's requiring all employers to offer this now, including church-affiliated organizations.
Right, but the key point here is that you can be employed by a church-affiliated organization, but not a member of that particular church.
But you don't have to work for it.
Churches
are. Well, it's not that.
Is it an infringement on religious liberty, Woody?
No.
Well, it's clearly that, but the real problem, I mean, we don't have time to go into the Constitution here. Let's do the politics. The U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, abortion aside, has pretty much been a wholly owned subsidiary of the Democratic Party. They just stuck a sharp stick in their eye, and it isn't going to be that way this time. And I think the politics of that are going to be ugly.
All right, we got to move on. Well, if you hold political office, Mary, we're going on. If you hold political office and you want some media attention, learn from freshman Missouri legislator Rick Brattin. The Harrisonville Republican attracted our notice just a couple of weeks ago by proposing that creationism be taught alongside evolution in state classrooms. Now, Brattin is focused on his fellow lawmakers, saying they should be subjected to random drug testing during the legislative session. I think we should live by the same standard we are asking others to live by, says Brattin. Our salaries are paid by taxpayers, so we should assure them we aren't using that money on drugs. Now, will Brattin's legislative proposal get as much attention from his peers as it gets from Ruckus and the rest of the media, Gwen?
No. Straight up, no. I think his peers, this legislation, Brattin, who's behaving somewhat like a brat, probably for his peers probably think, is he's tried numerous times attempts to get this legislation attached to other legislation with respect to TANF, the temporary assistance for needy families, which is where this originated. And a year ago, they passed a bill requiring these drug screenings for welfare recipients. But what many of the legislators feel about this is that that bill was really discriminatory in that it only singled out welfare recipients.
But what's the flaw in this? Where is Brattin going wrong on this proposal about lawmakers?
Well, when you look at if you look at it in the context of if we're saying that welfare recipients should have drug screening, then we should. Well, it's more of an issue of should anybody be getting the drug screening? If that's the case, if anyone who receives federal benefits, everyone should get a drug screening.
Does anybody think this legislation?
So if I'm a Medicaid recipient,
does anybody think this
I should get a drug screening?
Anybody think this legislation of Mr. Brattin is going to even get any attention from the legislature?
No, it's not getting any attention.
What it's
They're
doing
not letting
is
it
getting
out.
Our attention. That not, it's achieved its purpose because we're talking about it, and it appears in the papers. It's a publicity.
Is this good for him?
It's a publicity stunt, of course. Of course, it's kind of goofy bills that get introduced and get people like us talking about it on television.
Right.
But it's a goofy bill.
Yes, today, you wrote what I consider to be a very powerful column outlining shortcomings that you saw concerning state legislators and state legislatures in general, but specifically those in Missouri and Kansas.
Right.
Why were you so worked up and so heated?
Well, actually, over the last two or three weeks, I've been talking to a number of people on the City Council of Kansas, actually out in Johnson County, and then a couple business people that deigned to talk to me. and the constant theme is how little attention the Kansas City area gets on major issues from legislators in both states. I mean, and we have, let's face it, and I really didn't get into it in the column, but we don't really have a very good delegation either. I mean, we have some Democrats who aren't very powerful in Missouri because the Republicans are in charge, and over in Johnson County, where you'd think you could have real power, being the economic powerhouse of the state, they have a split of Democrats and Republicans, and I don't know, they just aren't that effective in a rural-centric legislature. So the bottom line is we have a lot of issues we're facing, like local control of police, but like school funding, road funding, various things like that, where you'd think, wow, people would recognize that this urban center is hugely important to both the states of Kansas and Missouri, and yet in general, we get short.
Well, you suggested the Missouri legislator might be the worst in the country.
Yes, and I was pummeled by a couple of people through Twitter on another person.
Let's see if
that should be somebody else.
Let's see if Woody, who lobbies the Missouri legislature, let's see if he pummels you. What was your reaction to Yale's column?
Yale was getting a little over the top. The Missouri General Assembly, and as a matter of fact, when the Republicans took over, and for a few years thereafter, Warren Erdman liked to point out, who works at Kansas City Southern and does a lot of work with the state legislature and is now on the Board of Curators, that Kansas City had actually done better in, the first 4 to 6 years the Republicans were in charge down there, out of state government, than they had ever done before when it was controlled by the party that most people in this area vote for, which is the Democratic Party. And that statement was true if you're just counting up pork and projects done. Now, lately, for, say, the last 2 to 4 years, that has not been the case.
All right.
So I don't know what the gripe is.
All right, we got to stop there. A district attorney's investigation was likely not on the Cedar Crest menu when Governor Sam Brownback invited influential Kansas lawmakers over for dinner. The argument is that state business was transacted at the private dinners and therefore violated the state's open meetings law. Shawnee County DA Chad Taylor has opened the probe in response to a complaint filed by the Topeka Capital Journal newspaper. Taylor acknowledges that this will be a tough case to make. But is this serious business or just a waste of everybody's time? Mary O'Halloran.
Oh, it's finally going to call on me here, Mike. I thought I'd never get asked.
Okay, thank you, Mary. Oh, no.
It was directed at the chair, Yale. Okay. It is a violation of the open meetings law. The open meetings law is a very important piece of legislation. It probably is the centerpiece of modern democratic process. And everybody knows about it. Everybody knows what it means. Every legislator understands it. But apparently the governor and his staff, they had 7 dinners. They had 13 different committees represented, and they had 90 legislators there for these successive dinners. And if you look at the Attorney General's website in Kansas, you'll see what is required. It's very simple. If you get together in a room and you have a discussion, and this is particularly pointed out by the Attorney General, if you have a discussion, that triggers the Open Meeting Act, and it has to be open to the public. There has to be an announcement of it, and it has to be announced what the subject is if you discuss state business. It's clear that they did discuss state business, and they went on and on and on and doing this 7 times. So I don't have any doubts that it was a violation. It's not a criminal act. But I think the fines will probably be levied as time goes on. The newspapers should be applauded.
You know, I would say on behalf of myself and other panelists, and I imagine the vast majority of people who watch Ruckus and have over the years, no one would believe you've had insufficient time to state your case today or any other day.
Now, Mike
O'Neill, the House Speaker, says, no, it ought to be fair for everybody to get a chance to talk. I'm going to try to move over here, if possible, if you're finished, and ask Yale about O'Neill's reaction. He said, we're not going to pay attention to this. We don't have that responsibility, at least not legally.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it is a political type of situation. I do agree with Mary that I think it was pretty cut and dried that they didn't handle it very well. They could have posted it. They could have invited a lot of Democrats and then, you know, not talked about state business. I mean, there are all kinds of ways of handling these things. But the problem is now that it's going to be portrayed as a political deal, which O'Neill will make it, you know, well, we got this Democrat after us, you know, so we're not going to cooperate with him. I don't think it's going to explode in Brownback's face or anything like that. I just think it's one of those things that was not handled correctly.
It would be a tough case to prove, as the DA said, would it not, what actually transpired at the meeting?
Well, sure. You've got, first of all, the governor can't violate the open meetings law. He's not a body or agency of the state. So do you have a majority of some committee in the room? Well, you probably do at some point. So let's say you got 5 guys in there off of a committee of 9. You now have a majority of the committee. Did you discuss the business of that committee? An issue that comes before that committee is the next question. And then the question is not quite as simple as Mary says it. Did the members of the committee discuss it? They can have a presentation from an outside person like the governor, and they can ask him questions. And there's an AG's opinion from back in 2009 that says, You haven't violated the Open Meetings mm-hmm. Act until the members of the committee start talking to each other
right.
about that state issue. Proving that is really going to be tough.
That's why it's so messy.
Well, the law.
And when you look at the law and all the technicalities, mm-hmm. that's true. But the bottom line is, it smells bad.
The
it looks bad, and it smells bad
right.
to the electorate. When you lawyers get in there, and you can make it say anything you want, but to those who elect those people to represent us or them,
right.
we expect them to behave and act with integrity in the process. And I think that's where
Mary, does this happen a lot? You were in the legislature in Iowa. Did this kind of incident occur? Did you take part in any of these kinds of meetings?
Until the 1970s, it was rampant all over the country. You bet. And there were secret meetings routinely of committees.
Were you in on them?
Never. No, I was the reformer. We opened up the system. And every state across the nation did. Every state has an open meetings law, which is a good thing.
All right. Some Kansas City civic and business leaders have... a get set to grown now, desire named streetcar.
Oh, I get it. Okay, I get
all
it.
Right, thank you. Yeah, okay. There must be not one, but two successful elections before September to put into motion the funding mechanisms for a streetcar system. The goal is to establish a downtown development district, which could lead to both local and federal tax dollars. Backers say time is of the essence. First, what is a downtown development district, Yale?
Well, basically, it goes from the city put out its frequently asked questions today, and one of them was, where does it go? Starts at River Market, goes down to around 31st Street, goes over, close to State Line, and then kind of over to about Locust or whatever there, and then just basically closes Crown Center, Crossroads, downtown River Market, in general. Kansas City Star is among those properties inside there. And so that district, eventually, if they vote in June, the registered voters who live in that area, 10,000, 12,000 people altogether, if they vote to form this district, then the registered voters probably later this year will decide, well, do we increase property taxes on the businesses and residents who live in that area, as well as a higher sales tax? And then all the money from that district, just from this area, will help fund the streetcar. It's a system that's used in other parts of Kansas City. I mean, there are community improvement districts in downtown already, which charges a little bit higher fee, so the downtown people can have those yellow suit people.
The organizations and people who benefit most are the ones who are asked to pay?
Yes.
Is that the concept?
To me, that is the essential thing here. The city has decided we're not going to go for another citywide tax.
Really?
We're just going to go for the two, the
sorry,
area
Woody.
Where the area of the 2 mile streetcar is going to go first, River Market to Crown Center. The theory is this is going to be not really a great transit thing. It's going to be economic development. Somebody will want to build an office building right next to a permanent streetcar line. And, it's been tried in other cities. It's worked. We'll see if it works.
What do you think, Gwen? Is this a good project?
Well, in the spirit of full disclosure, I need to state that I'm on the board of directors for the Kansas City Regional Transit Authority, and we think it's a good project.
Is there a board you don't serve on?
I don't serve on any paying boards. Can you give me one of those?
No, people who make profits.
But the... we think it's a good idea in that it initiates a streetcar process. There's federal funding associated with it, but there are some yellow flags, I think, of caution. And the Star pointed those out today in their editorial, in that the city needs to be extremely careful in assessing costs so that it does not come back to be a burden on the general fund.
Now, this is all contingent, I believe, Mary, on an application by the city to the federal government and the grant of $25 million.
A chunk, yes. And today, as I understand it, 6 of the city council people pledged $100,000 each to come out of their district's PIAC allotment toward this project, and so there is wide support for it on the council and in City Hall in general. $25 million from the Department of Transportation is much, but there are people questioning the Port Authority's relationship to this project, so that'll be part of the issue to watch.
Woody, is this a major project, major priority for Kansas City?
Obviously, it is in the view of the mayor and some of the council members. The thing about, as the father of transportation development districts in the state of Missouri, I'm looking at my illegitimate child here, and they do a good thing in that they do what Yale described, to let the people most directly involved decide whether they want this thing and to basically fund it. The weakness in it is you're saying to the voters citywide, we know we better not let you into this game. The purpose of this is to get some momentum going for rail transportation in Kansas City. That's not a good start to do it as a TDD. You're not building much momentum. Nonetheless, that said, this is what TDDs are for. That's what they're intended for.
Is there any connection between this and the project the county is working on and Mike Sanders and other than they're both transportation?
No, I mean, ultimately there could be, because if the Union Station does become the hub, or, you know, those the heavy rail come in and connect anywhere and you can get to a streetcar line, that would be good. And my piggyback would be, and if it goes down to Country Club Plaza in 8 years, and the TDD gets bigger and bigger, more the city buys in.
Okay, I got to ask you one more question before we run out of time on this segment. The mayor issued his thoughts about the city manager's proposed budget today. You've taken a look. We'll probably go into detail next week, but any initial assessment?
The two big things. One, he is not going to laying off 105 firefighters. He is going to support having the fire chief decide how to reduce the fire budget by $7.5 million. Guess what? Dyer's not going to lay off, 105 firefighters. Second thing, he wants to have...
Will he reduce the
Well, I think so. I think he's almost going to have to if you're going to have $7.5 million out of that. But, you know, Smokey's a nationally acclaimed expert, according to the mayor, and he will do that. And the second thing is, he called for 10 years of $100 million of general obligation bond elections every year, and these would involve tax increases. So $1 billion over 10 years, that could be big.
Go back over that again.
$1 billion of general obligation bonds to do for infrastructure, improvements, not water stuff, but actual streets, roads, that kind of stuff, over the next 10 years. $100 million a year of elections over the next 10 years.
What do you think of that, Mary? Is that a worthwhile idea?
Well, we'll see how it works out.
Okay. Gwen, any interest in that?
Well,
elections?
Yeah.
Annually. Okay, now it's time for Roast and Toast, where the pundits on the panel pick what to cheer and jeer. And we go first tonight with Gwen.
Well, I'm going to toast the Susan B. Komen Foundation for recognizing the error of its ways and reversing its decision to defund Planned Parenthood. I'm glad to see that they were able to say, oops, we're sorry.
A toast to the 16 Republican members of the Missouri House of Representatives who did not follow their leadership in supporting the so-called jobs bill that actually makes it more difficult for people who are fired for whistleblowing and so on to sue. And that the leadership has backed this at the request of one company in St. Louis and has pushed it very hard. It takes some guts for a member, especially a freshman member, to resist the leadership these 16 did. And that means when the bill gets vetoed, the veto will be upheld and this will not become bad law in Missouri.
Well, this is a toast to more than 3,000 Kansas City firefighters and police officers who right now are pretty mad at me. One, for telling the police officers they got to get involved in the city health insurance plan, and two, the firefighters are saying it's not a bad idea to go ahead and save some money and get rid of firefighting jobs. They've been posting on the blog response to what I write. More than 200 police officers showed up today to protest what's happening at City Hall. A couple of them on the way out were making snide comments about, gee, I hope you get your facts right here. You guys are carrying the guns. Walk up and have a conversation with me. Don't be so shy in the future. Thank you.
Double toast today. First to Secretary Kathleen Sebelius, former governor of Kansas, for standing up strong on the whole issue of whether or not American women can have access to birth control in every working situation in which they find themselves. 62% of American women support the president and the secretary. Secondly, a big toast to former Congressman Dennis Moore and his wife Stephanie for making public the fact that Dennis has Alzheimer's. Another reason why he is the man that he is and why we all admire him so much.
A quick toast to the Kansas City musicians who were featured in a segment on Michael Feinstein's American Songbook, which aired on KCPT last Friday. Feinstein stopped by the Mutual Musicians Association in the 18th and Vine District and took part in an early morning jam session. A couple of the local guys I recognized, Mike Ning on piano and Victor Perlmutter on drums. You can see more of Michael Feinstein's jam session at the Mutual Musicians Foundation on the local show coming up next. And that's Ruckus for this week. Nick Haynes will host Kansas City Week in Review Friday evening at 7:30. Now, on behalf of the Ruckettes and our producer, Sean Holmes, I'm Mike Shannon. Thanks for watching, and good night.
Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the generous contributions from Fred and Lou Hartwig, and from viewers like you. Thank you.